question being drawn out, and you just wait for the next thing being chucked at us, and then we just go like, okay, bring it on, because this is kind of like where we are at. It's like 2 years of what somebody called it, manure show. Just bring an explode. So this is kind of like we're exhausted, we are drawn out, and we are now at a level of expectancy of more of it coming. Because this is where we are at now, 2 years later, plus minus, of course. But I think what is the danger in all of this? Yes, we've learned we are way more resilient than we ever thought we would need to be. We found a lot of resources we didn't know we had. We also found out that we cannot just deal with certain so-called pandemics, but also with things like riots on top of it all, and, asthma on top of it all. So we can do it all. South Africans, I think, is one of the most resilient nations in the world. But beyond that, if you go one step back on this, it's like us as human beings, we are utterly come to the bottom of our resources. If we look at ourselves, not in the roles we play, but ourselves as human beings, as energetic beings, we draw out, we're done. We're literally done. We are so now on reaction mode that we don't even know how we work anymore. We don't know what feeds us anymore. We don't know what gets us up anymore. We just about trying to make it through there. We completely lost what's in, what's out, what's up, what's down, what's back, what's front. We just want to make it through the next day. And that's a dangerous thing. Because it's unmaintainable. It's just not maintainable. So if we look at this whole kind of like pandemic and unrest and all those nonsense, what we're really dealing with is the pandemic of fear. It's not about the virus. It's not even about the economy. It's about, if you look at how people are split and divided and down each other's throats, it brings out the worst of everybody, including us. Our nerves are that thin. Why? Because we're out of energy. We've forgotten to reload because we are in survival mode. And of course, it's not going to bring the hunky-dory and fluffy out of us. Of course not. It cannot. It's impossible. And as we all know, like mind, body, and soul are always placed together. If the one gets exhausted, the next one tries to help out, or this one gets exhausted, and so on and so on. So sooner or later, all three are going like, I'm done with this. Who isn't exhausted? Hands up, who is exhausted? And I don't just mean like a woman, like I have one night sleep and I'm fine. I'm talking soul exhausted. You sleep 12 hours, you wake up and you're like, oh my word. That kind of exhausted. The kind of exhausted, you walk up a flight of stairs and you're like, that kind of exhausted. The kind of exhausted, the normal kind of chores, and your normal kind of day, the thought of it already goes like, I need a nap. That kind of exhausted. That meeting with friends or with things that normally feed you, you go like, oh, I'm not. Now, can you see how unhealthy that is? Because we are on reaction mode. And even feeling who we are, putting ourselves in a better space, is now an exhausting thought. And this is how this whole catch 22 just runs and runs and runs. On top of it, well, we have to dodge media. We have to dodge those that might hold a different opinion on vaccines, the whatever is out there nowadays. Because nowadays you need to watch, you don't get shot if you have a different opinion. Then there's this whole thing. Well, it's like people get angry about it because they have such strong belief systems. And there's nothing wrong with having different belief systems. But when we are in a response system and fight and flight, our belief system becomes our survival system. And then we get aggro, which makes sense because it's like if you don't do what I believe, that means I'm going to drop dead, so you better flip and do it. There is no more logic in it. And then we try to avoid that. It splits families. The real pandemic we're dealing with is fear. It saps us of everything besides energy. It saps us of logic. And that's actually scientific, and I'm not hard, because when we are in fight or flight or fear mode, literally the brain doesn't have enough fuel to feed the logical brain. There's actually long names for it. It's called amygdala honey shack. Fight and flight literally puts all the energy into the amygdala, which goes like, hell no, enemy doesn't agree, shoot. It literally works like that in the brain. This is before you talk energy. This is why people that would have been quite chilled and reasonable people, all of a sudden, they go like, what happened? They're generally not bad people, but they're now stuck or like locked in that fight flight mode. And everybody just wants it to end. So everybody just kind of like, if everybody just does what is said or what I want or what I believe, it's going to end. And then go again. And also what happens, what's a dangerous thing is, we've been now trained for 2 years to look at what we want to avoid. Now that is another bummer, because the law of energy is, what we are concentrating on, we get more of. So we're concentrating on, we don't want the violence, we don't want the riots, we don't want division, we don't want, so we look at everything we don't want and at the same time create more. You open the media, the numbers, the figures, we always look at what we don't want. Exclusively, you talk to people, it's like, oh, the numbers are like that, so many are vaccinated, so many are not, this province, it's everything you don't want. And I'm not saying ignore what's there, but we need to start concentrating on what we do want. This whole kind of seismic blasting down the coast, of course it's horrendous. Everybody goes against Shell. People, against the blasting. What about the marine life? We've got to be careful what we concentrate on, we feed. We literally make an energetic investment into that. So yes, know what you don't want, then find the opposite, and then invest like there is no tomorrow. So you don't want fear? Invest in love. You don't want grumpy? Invest in kindness. But we started matching it. Why are we matching it? Because we shorten our own energy. So matching is easier in the nature of reaction and actually going like, oh, and we take a deep breath and, like I said, kill it with kindness. Not literally, of course, but it's tempting at times, but no. But it's literally because it is not a general energy, it's so easy to be sucked into that. The pandemic is fear. And fear divides. And division gets every agenda in. It does not matter if it's the political agenda, if it's, I don't know, some business people, I really don't care. Division allows any agenda. It just opens up the field. So this is about also, it keeps our focus outside. This is not where our power lays. This is where our power lays. So as long as they keep us like, hey, we want to avoid this, we want to avoid that, we want to avoid this, we're constantly just shielding, but we're not going like, hold it, let me like maximize my power, who I am, and then feed into what I want, which is a way more healthier kind of like motion, and I can maintain it, and I am way more healthy and stable, and that can be maintained. And will automatically wash that out. It becomes an inside-out motion instead of an outside-in motion. I'm not in reaction mode, I'm in action mode. So we must stop fighting all this nonsense that we don't want and create what we do want. Does not mean we agree. Does not mean we agree. But I can sit and argue with you, or I can go off and create. The time is the same, the energy is different, it feels much lighter as well. And the outcome will be quite different as well. The moment you find it, And yes, the world is upside down at the moment, but is it really such a bad thing? It wasn't perfect before that. There was enough mourning and groaning going on before that. And every time something is upside down, it opens so many areas that weren't there before. And that is a wonderful thing. Everything is neutral until we attach something to it. Everything. And then people say, oh, it's like one of the worst times, and it's difficult, or it's this, and others go like, darn, my business is booming. Well, same circumstances. How come two people have two complete different realities attached to it? Not the one is lucky and the other isn't. They have different actions and different viewpoints to it. The reality, like what played out, was the same. So this whole, like what's happening at any given time in the world, depends on how much resistance we have to it and what our angle is to it. Everything is neutral. Absolutely everything. And yes, sometimes it takes longer to wrap our brain around it than at other times. And what I normally hear is like, but it isn't easy. Well, if it's easy or not, it's an attachment as well. It might be easy for somebody who runs the Comrades to run the next one. It might not be easy for me, who I already have to puff out my driveway. But for the person who runs the Comrades, it might not be easy to stand here and do what I do. For me, it's like I get up and just do it. It is not easy until we familiarize ourselves with it, until we spend time with it. The only difference between easy and hard is the familiarizing and how much time we spend with it. That's the only difference. That's really the only difference in how much resistance we have to it. That's really it. Again, it's neutral. It's neutral. Absolutely neutral. I have great resistance to running. So it was like, eh, not happening. And my head is like, I do this for 5 hours before I run half an hour down the road, which is a choice, but it's most likely going to be the other way around. There's no wrong or right, but the resistance to it makes it in my head like, ooh, flip no. So, but give me 50 people for 5 hours, got it. No problem. Again, because this is where I know, it's fine. But again, this is like what I feel aligned to. So this whole bucket is not easy because it's you, because you haven't been there yet. So these times that we are in right now, then we're here or there. Are they different? That they are. Does it allow a lot of new areas? Yes, it do. The only thing we need to do is, are we in those times? Are we really in these times? Or are we in reaction to these times? Because that is what determines how you feel about it. You don't have to like every part of it at all. But you can choose to align yourself with the parts that are yours instead of objecting to those that aren't yours. And that will change and completely determine how you experience those times. A lot of wonderful stuff came out of this. A lot of things fell away, and quite frankly, not all of the things that fell away was a bad thing. People showed their true faces, businesses showed their true faces, government showed their true faces. There is a great kind of spring cleaning effect going on in all of this as well. Because now the thumbscrews were on, there was no more hiding behind the closets kind of thing going on. Is this a gift? That's for you to decide. I think it is. I don't know who is who in the suit. Did it bring out more humanity? Like, look at the riots. Was it horrendous in one side? Absolutely. Did it bring communities closer together? I got to know neighbors I didn't know I had. Plus one makes really great bread. Both of us, I'm still having it. But it's like, it might be small things, but I think it made it very important. What is it? Very clear what is important, what isn't. What really counts and what doesn't count. Who really counts and who doesn't count. You've got to bring it back home. Stop having discussions with people who should do what. It's everybody's prerogative to make their decisions, no matter what it is. If it's where they want to work, who they want to date, who they want to marry, what objections they want to have or not, that's fine. I always say it stops when they start trying to shove it down somebody else's orifices, but then you just say no, thank you. But that's all it is. They're entitled to that. Let's get away from having to convince other people they need to do as I say. Their reality is as valid as mine. It's not worth it. My job is not to convince other people what to do. Our job is to live our life according to the best for me. It's not my job to tell other people what to do. I don't even know half the time what to do in my own life. How dare I tell other people? You have no right to do that. Can we guide when they ask? Of course we can. Can we insist? No, we can't. And I don't want to have this responsibility either. So let's take it back home. Let's get back from reaction. Let's get away from fear. Let's start living again. We can't live in being reaction mode. When last did any of you have a good old belly laugh? Yeah, right, I thought this much. You can't remember. Because you can't be in fear mode and still live. Because you know where fear lives? In the future. Avoidance lives in the future. You never in here and now when you're in fear mode. This is where life happens, it's here and now. Fear is like, I want to avoid this, I want to avoid that, and then there is worry, and then there is this, and there's more avoidance. Avoidance and fear and worry keeps you in the future, takes you away from here and now. Worry is always about the next thing. Always, exclusively. It doesn't matter if it's about the kids' school, or like me moving, or going to be another riot, or me going to be infected, or whatever it might be. Worry and fear keeps you in the future. It steals life. And be volunteering it. That's us volunteering. Nothing can exist in our life unless we co-create, allow, or feed it. You can bring anything to me. If I don't somehow volunteer to interact with it, it doesn't have space in my heart. So we need to get away with like, they need to do this, they need to do that. It would be nice if they volunteer that sometimes. But even if they don't, then it's on me to shift, like say, okay, where am I co-creating this? Where am I allowing this? And where am I feeling this if I want a different outcome? We need to start living. We need to come back into the here and into the now. Fear is the opposite. We need to come back home. This pandemic is about fear. Every pandemic is about fear. Absolutely every pandemic is about fear. Every war is about fear. It's about fear and division. The more fear, the easier the games are played. Oldest game in the book. The oldest game in the book. It was like this whole divide and conquer and roll that time already, never heard that. Same thing, what divides more that you can conquer? Fear. If it's done with violence, or if it's done via now with the more modern kind of weapons, like viruses kind of thing, and it doesn't matter if they were done in a lab or if it was a natural one, it is what it is, it's being used as a weapon. It's fear. Bring it back home. Bring it back home. Start living. That's the antidote to fear. Bring joy back. And that's on you. Concentrate on what you do want in your life. And if you have grumpy people around you, have a bit less of them at the moment. That doesn't mean that you're not bad people. I'm not saying cut everybody out. But they need to go through those processes in their own time. There's nothing wrong with you saying, I'm distancing myself a little bit right now because it's not my energy. You can send another light, but over there. Nothing wrong with that. You do not owe anybody to be in a bad energy field. Sometimes, in times like this, it's actually better for both parties to be left from a distance. Because sometimes getting out of the way is the bigger gift than being in the way. So this is about living. Come coming back into the here and the now. Have joy. Have fun. And I'm sure I'm talking too long in. So to just finish. So let me finish off with a little poem that I found written by Tova Kirby. And it goes, celebrate the beautiful, the difficult and the wonderful, and the complicated. It's all meant to be lived fully, to be embraced with passion and enthusiasm. We were born unique, so don't cover up your shine or set aside your magic just to fit into this world and its agendas. Instead, use your gifts to reshape your life. Add color to each day with your voice and your vision. Leave a legacy of wonder so others may be encouraged to do the same. Thank you.